University and Directorate Research and Community Service, Directorate General of Higher Education, the Ministry of Research, Technology and Higher Education, Republic of Indonesia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Felix Saputra. Such a great presentation. And on the second presenter at the first subsession, I will invite Ms. Golda Saragi from Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. So for co-house, please play the video. Thank you. I'm so sorry for the technical difficulties. We would like to replay the video from Ms. Golda Saragi. Please enjoy the presentation. Thank you very much.
Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming to this event of the first ICHAFES 2021. It's an honor to meet you here in my presentation. Let me introduce myself first. My name is Golda Saragi and I am from Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. In this opportunity, I'd like to explain about my research entitled Morphological Study of the Lingual Papillae of Gentis Flying Squirrel or Hylopis platyurus. The Gentis flying squirrel, also known as the gray-cheeked flying squirrel or Hylopis platyurus or bajing terbang, is a mammal of the order Rodentia. 8 to 9 small flying squirrel species in the genus Hylopis are native to Southeast Asia. It is distributed throughout the Malay Peninsula and on the island of Borneo and Sumatra, Indonesia. Tongue or lingua is an organ that has a taste function. Anatomically, tongue is divided into 3 parts, apex, corpus, and radix. Papilla is the part of the tongue that functions as a taste, temperature, and pain receptor. Different types of animals based on their diet cause different types, amounts, and forms of papillae. Lingual papillae becomes an important topic in knowing the lingual morphological structure of animals. Researchers on lingual morphology in animals, especially squirrels, have been carried out by researchers around the world. But the authors have not found any publications containing research on Hylopis platyurus, even though these animals are often found in the environment around us. The result of the gross morphology of the tongue of flying squirrel has 3 distinct regions. Apex, which is the most rostral part, the corpus, known as lingual body, and the radix, which is the most caudal part. There is a groove in the center of the tongue called median groove, and there are also 3 falate papilla on the radix forming a V shape. This is the schematic dorsal view of the tongue of flying squirrel, where we can see the distribution of each papilla. Scanning electron microscope of the apex showed that in the tip of the apex, we can see the median groove, and there are short filiform papilla and fungiform papilla found distributed along the surface. Foliate papilla were located among filiform papillae, and long filiform papillae covered posterior half of the apex. The long filiform papillae are similar in structure to the short filiform papillae, but significantly longer. In the corpus area, we can also find fungiform and long filiform papillae, and there are conical papillae that forms radiating patterns in symmetrical position. Fungiform papillae are also distributed among the long filiform and conical papillae in this area. The long filiform papillae located on the posterior of the corpus. In the radix area, there are 3 types of papillae. Those are conical, large conical, and palatine papillae. The large conical papillae filled both on the lateral sides, while three palatine papillae occupying the posterior part of the radix, forming a V-shape and close to the larynx. Hematoxylin eosin staining revealed three tissue layers in the tongue, namely lamina epithelialis, lamina mucosa, and lamina muscularis mucosa. The limual mucosa consisted of a layer of muscle fibers, namely transversal and longitudinal fibers. Histological study of the apex revealed three types of papilla, namely filiform, puniform, and foliate. The filiform papillae are highly keratinized and are highly keratinized with sharp and thin edges. The fungiform papillae are spherical in shape and fully keratinized, bearing taste buds inside of it. The foliate papillae are spherical in shape and thinly keratinized also. The foliate papillae were also observed among filiform papillae. Histological study of the corpus revealed long filiform, conical, and fungiform papillae. The long filiform and fungiform papillae had the same characteristic as those of the apex. The conical papillae have thick keratinization and conical shape, and a conical shape and had a blunt tip. Histological study of the radix revealed conical, large conical, and palatine papillae. The palatine papillae are round and bound with walls created by epithelial invagination. It's larger than the other papillae and covered with a thin layer of keratin. It has many more taste buds compared to fungiform papillae. The large conical papillae are triangular with sharp edges and thick layer of keratin. The conical papillae have the same characteristic as those of the corpus but larger in size. For the conclusion, this is the distribution and measurements of the lingual papillae on the tongue of flying squirrel, where in the apex area, we can see that there are short filiform papilla, long filiform papilla, fungiform papilla, and foliate papilla. And in the corpus area, we can find long filiform papilla, conical filiform papilla, and fungiform papilla. And in the radix area, we can find conical filiform papilla, large conical papilla, fungiform papilla, and palatine papilla. At last, I'd like to thank and give credits to my research group for the support throughout the process and to Kemenristekdikti for funding this research. Thank you very much for your great attention, ladies and gentlemen. May all those information we have shared could be beneficial for all of us. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Ms. Gulda Saragi. On the third presenter, we will invite Ms. Angelina Kusuma Anjani with the research title, Morphological Study of the Lingua of Domesticated Asian Small-Clawed Otter in Yogyakarta, Indonesia. So for co-host, please play the video. Enjoy the presentation. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Angelina Anjani from Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. I'm glad to meet you all virtually in IJAFES 221 to talk about morphological study of the lingual papillae of the domesticated small-clawed otter for Onyx cinereus in Yogyakarta, Indonesia. First, I would like to introduce you to the subject of this research, which is Asian small-clawed otter or Onyx cinereus, known locally as Berang-Berang. It is a semi-aquatic animal can be found in Southeast and East Asia region, including Indonesia. They have become an alternative pets because of their physical characteristics and personalities, which constitutes resembling cats and dogs. So this phenomenon, increasing the changes of the habitual behavior of Onyx cinereus, which was originally a wild animal, to a domestic animal that lives closely to humans. This encourages changes in dietary patterns of the Onyx cinereus. Next is the organ of this research, which is tongue or lingua. It is a muscular digestive organ located in cavum oris, functions primarily for food processing. It is then divided into three parts, the apex, the corpus, and the radix. The lingua papillae covers the dorsal surface of the tongue. The study has shown that tongue papilla in animal differs in terms of the distribution and the shape of the papilla. Moving on to the research objective. So studies have revealed that variations in the morphology and distribution of lingual papillae among a lot of animal species is unique and very specific. However, there is still no scanning electron microscope or SAM study of the tongue, this onyx cinereus, that has been performed before. Without further ado, let's get to see the results of this research, including the cross microscopy and the SAM result. The first one for the cross microscopy, we can see the tongue of the onyx cinereus and divided into apex corpus radix. The apex is the most rostral part that can move freely. And then the corpus or the body is the biggest part of the tongue. It is then divided into anterior and posterior corpus. So the corpus is characterized by the median groove. The last one is the radix or the root of the tongue. It is characterized by six circumphalatae forming a V formation. The picture next to it, it's a schematic picture of the papillary distribution in onyx cinereus, which then I will explain to you for each region. So the first is the apex region. It's right here. In the apex region, we can see the two types of filiform. The first one is the horny filiform. It is in the tip of the apex with blunt point. It has blunt point. The next one, which covers almost all apex region, is the leaf-like filiform. It has sharp edges and some processes. Thus, we can see the fungiform papillae scattered along the apex region in between the filiform papillae. Next is the corpus region or the body. Here we can see five types of filiform and fungiform papillae. So for the filiform papillae, in the anterior part, the anterior corpus, we can see the bifid and trifid filiform papilla. The bifid has two processes while trifid has three. It is located side by side. Well, in the medial part, the anterior corpus, we can find the conflower papilla. For the posterior part of the corpus, we can see mostly is elongated leaf-like filiform. This elongated leaf-like filiform. And then in the posterior lateral part, we can see the triangular filiform papilla, which resembles the triangle without any obvious processes. And also in the corpus region, it also scattered around is some fungiform papillae. The last one is the radix region. In this region, we can see some conical papilla, the short one and the long one, and the circumphalate papilla. So for the medial part, it is covered by the short conical papilla, while the lateral part is the long conical papilla. In this radix region, there are six of circumphalate papilla. It is surrounded by a wall and a groove that follows the form of the papillae. In this region, we can also see some fungiform papillae. In conclusion, in onyx cinereus, we cannot find any folate papillae, but there are a lot of types in terms of filiform papillae. There are seven types, two of them, the horny and the leaf-like filiform, we can see in the apex. And the next one, the pivot, trifid, cornflower, elongated, and triangular filiform papillae we can find in the corpus. For the radix, we can find the short conical and long conical. For the gustatory papillae, there are circumvallate papillae in the radix and milk fungiform papillae all along the tongue from the apex or into the radix. Here you can also see the mean length and width for each type of papillae. Lastly, I would like to say thank you to all the people and the institution that made this research happen. My beloved team, Universitas of Gajah Mada, and also the Ristek Dikti for funding this research. It is the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening and have a good day.
Have a good day too. Thank you very much. Such a great presentation from Ms. Angelina Anjani. And the last of this session, I mean, the last of this subsession, still from the Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada, we will invite Mr. Stanislaus Ivan Davin Pradipta. So please, for co-host to play the video. Enjoy the presentation.
My name is Stanislaus Ivan Davin Pradipta. Today, I will present our research in HFS 20 and 21. The title is Morphology Study of the Callosaurus Notatus Tongue by Scanning Electron Microscopy and Light Microscopy. The background of our research: first, Callosaurus Notatus was found in Peninsular Thailand and Peninsular Malaysia, Sumatra, Java, Bali, Lombok, and Borneo. Their diets consist of whole grains, fruit, leaf shoot, flower, insect, arthropod, tree bark, and resin. The diversity of the morphology between species are influenced by the multiple ways of picking up and processing food, grooming, or focal modulation, morphology, distribution, and the type of vertebrate lingual papilla is influenced by diet. There have not been many studies on tongue morphology surface in three dimensions. There are no recent data that describe tongue morphology of Callosaurus notatus in detail. This study will discuss the morphology of tongue and lingual papilla of Callosaurus notatus using scanning electron microscope and histochemical stain. And this is our result. Microscopic Callosaurus notatus tongue are divided into three regions: apex, corpus, and radix. The dorsal surface of the apex is divided into anterior parts, lateral parts, and medial parts. A median groove is visible on the anterior parts. Corpus dorsal surface is divided into lateral parts and medial parts. The lateral parts of corpus can be determined from the lateral prominence and fossa lingua appeared in the median parts in between its lateral section. Microscopically, trifoliate papilla can be found on the dorsal surface of the radix alongside with fungiform papilla. And this is scheme of Callosaurus notatus tongue. Then this is the picture, our result of scanning electron microscope. Scanning electron microscope observation show the distribution and variation of the lingual papilla morphology on the dorsal surface of the tongue. There are two types lingual papilla. Mechanic papilla consists filiform and conical, and gustatory papilla consists fungiform and fallate. First, same result of apex. Picture A shows you a wall part of apex, and the other pictures show you the toilet of distribution papilla in apex. In the apex, we can find the flag filiform papilla, fungiform papilla, and bifid filiform papilla. Second, same result of corpus. Picture A show you a wall part of corpus, and the other picture show you a detail of distribution papilla in corpus. In the corpus, we can find solid filiform papilla, fungiform papilla, bifid filiform papilla, white leaf like filiform papilla and fumiform papilla. Third, same result of radix. Picture A show you a wall part of radix and the other picture show you the toilet of distribution papilla in radix. In the radix, we can find conical like filiform. Palatal papilla is around by a wall and a sulcus and fumiform papilla. And then the result of hematocellular eosin stain. Hematocellular eosin staining revealed that the callosus notatus tongue has two layers, tunica mucosa and tectus muscularis striatus syncytialis. Tunica mucosa were divided into lamina epithelialis mucosa, which are arranged from epithelium, stratificatum, squamosum, and lamina propria mucosae. In line with the same observation, the histological finding also show several types of papilla: filiform, uniform, conical, and palatine. First, the result of hematocellular eosin stain of apex. In picture C and D, histological observation show that filiform papilla on the apex were consist of epithelium stratificatum squamosum cornificatum with the keratinized. Leaf-like filiform papilla have slender and pointed tips, while bifid filiform papilla have a tips of lamina epithelial that splits in two. In picture B, fungiform papilla were less observed in between filiform papilla. This papilla composed by epithelium stratificatum squamosum cornificatum with thin keratinized. The dorsal surface was equipped by a taste bud, enabling the papilla to perform taste recognition. Second, the result of hematocellular eosin stain of corpus. In picture A and D, the result revealed the lingual papilla on the corpus was dominated by high keratinized of the epithelium. In picture B, solid filiform papilla has a wide shape with lamina propria mucosa and lamina epithelialis mucosa divided into more than two processes with a thick keratinized. In picture C, bifid filiform papilla on the corpus has a shape resembled letter U with a more obtuse loophole in the lamina propria mucosa followed by the cleaving of lamina epithelialis mucosa. In figure E, leaf-like filiform papilla has a wide figure with thick epithelium stratificatum cornificatum. In picture F, fungiform papilla were covered by thin keratinized with a taste bud on the dorsal surface. Third, the result of hematocellular eosin of radix. The radix exhibited four types of papilla: fungiform, conical, like filiform, palatae, and conical in picture A. In picture B, fungiform papilla have a larger, rounded, resembling a dome with a taste bud on the dorsal surface. In picture C, conical like filiforms, shaped like a wide leaf-like filiform papilla with thicker lamina epithelialis mucosa and the lamina propria mucosa more point resemble a horn. In picture E, palatal papilla have a rounded shape and surrounded by a canal and outer wall which formed by invagination in the surface of the epithelium around this papilla with several taste buds present on its lateral wall. Picture D, von Ebner glands can be observed in the tectus muscularis striatus syncytialis of palatal papilla. In conclusion, the research provides detailed morphological information of the tongue and lingual papilla of callosus notatus based on observation using scanning electron microscope and light microscope. This is the distribution and measurement of the lingual papilla of the tongue of callosus notatus. At the end of the presentation, I would like to say thank you to my research group for helping me through the process and to Receptivity for funding this research. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pradipta and his research team. I think because the four first subsession are discussing about this almost the same subject, so we put it together, and now it's the time for Q&A session. We remind you again, please kindly to write a question for the presenter in the chat box. It's such a great innovation and invention about knowing more about our local species. I appreciate for your research team. And according to your research, maybe I will ask to all the team, which one of you who will answer, it's up to the team. What were the other aspects that you and your team found in your research besides the surface of the lingual? For example, like a vascularization or nervous system or specific muscle that you found in the research. Would you mind to answer my question? Thank you very much.
Okay, so
Ms. Golda, would you mind to turn off your camera? Maybe because of the unstable. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, the connection is really yes. bad in here.
Yeah, it's okay. You can turn better? Off your camera.
Okay.
Better.
For our research group, lately we try to add more of a staining method like AB pass. So it's not like we try to find the vascularization or the nervous, but we try to see like the carbohydrate staining. So we can see like the glandular in the lingual in the muscle layer. Like we are working on that currently.
Okay. Is there any additional statement from other group?
For right now, we haven't tried to find more, but we try to explore like more of the local animals, like the before we were working on some mammals, but right now we try to work on some animal from the reptile. That's
okay. Do you find something interesting and correlation maybe between the type of food and the type of the surface of the lingual?
Yeah, we found that there is a correlation between their diets and the morphology. From some of the animals, like in the herbivores animal, we sometimes can find that there is a prominence in their tongue, but for animals that is more like omnivore, it is absent. It's like, and also the difference between their shape of the filiform papilla are also different. So we try to connect that the morphology that we found with the diet of the animal.
Okay. Thank you very much, Ms. Aragi. We have questions in the chat box. We have two questions already sent. First from Mrs. Padita and Mr. Sidik Setio. From Mrs. Padita, hello, thank you for your interest presentation. What else the things that can be associated with the tongue comparison among the species? What else? Maybe what else the thing that can be associated with the tongue comparison among the species, maybe besides the type of diet and so on. If I have mistake interpret your questions, please for Mrs. Padeta to correct me, please. Okay, for the team, Ms. Golda or Daphne or others, please, if you want to answer, we can activate your microphone.
If I may answer, the thing that is associated between those animals is like, we found some kind of papilla that is similar but not the same, like the like in general we can divide those papilla into two groups, that is the mechanical and the gustatory. Overall it's all the same, but like in the gustatory papillae, in my animals that we can find the foliate, but in other that it is absent. And the foliate papilla, we can see that the number is is different in each animals, but it all has the same function, like to increase their palatability so that they can choose what they want to eat, all those animals. I think that's it, or
yes. It's clear, Ms. Aragi. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. And then the next question from Mr. Siddiq. Morphological variation is very interesting topic. Is there any possibility in the lingua papillae variations among population in the same species in different location? Maybe in the different island of Indonesia.
Okay. If I may answer again, I think there might be a possibility because even if the animal is in the same place, as we might say, if the diet is different, it can affect the growth of their papillae. Like in my case, the animal, we don't get the animal from like the forest. We don't catch it from like the forest. Like we actually bought it from like the people who hunt it, and the animal is like, it was kind of like domesticated for like a few weeks or months, and we believe that because their food is given by the people who catch them, it will make a slight difference in their in the form of their papillae. So yeah, I think there will be a difference if it's from the different island over.
Okay, thank you very much for the answer. Yes, and we hope that you and your team can do the research more, start from lingual and then other gastrointestinal system, so we can study more and you can share to the world about your result. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Skolda, Angelina, Mr. Davin, and Felix. And this is the end of the first subsession. The next subsession will be guided with my colleagues, Dr. Alfarisa Nurul Rozi. We will have the three next presenter. We have Mr. Siddiq Setyonugroho and Mrs. Ariana. And then the third presenter will be Mr. Denny Setyo Wibowo. Okay. And for Dr. Alfarisa Nurul Rozi, please carry on to conduct this discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dinar. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone, all the participants of the first ISAFES conference. My name is Alfarisa Rozi. I am a young staff from Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Gajah Mada University. And now I will continue Dr. Dinar's job to conduct these seminars, especially in the second session of this group. So, similar with the first session, in the second group, we will have 300 speakers. And firstly, the video will be played first, then followed by the discussion session. So, for the second session, we have our three speakers. The first one, Mr. Sidik Setio Nugroho. The second one will be presented by Ms. Ariana. And the third one will be presented by Ms. Deni Setio Wibowo. So for all participants, if you have any question, please write your question in the text box. So let's start our first presentation for the second groups. I would like to invite our first speaker in this session, Mr. Sidik Setio Nugroho. For Ms. Setio Nugroho, time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Firstly, I want to say thank you for the priceless opportunity to deliver a presentation of our paper. My name is Sidik Setio Nugroho, and I'm currently working as a junior researcher in Institute for Vector and Reservoir Control Research and Development, belongs to Ministry of Health. Without further ado, please allow me to share my screen. Our paper entitled Species Distribution Update of Mansonia Mosquitoes in Indonesia. Mansonia mosquitoes for a long time have recognized as vector for lymphatic filariasis as well as several elbow filariasis. Mansonia have a nearly worldwide distribution. The majority of species are tropical. This genus is divided into two subgenera, namely Mansonia and Mansoniades. Species of subgenus Mansonia occur in the New World and those of subgenus Mansoniades occur in the Old World, including Indonesia. 8 out of 10 species of subgenus Mansoniades are occur in Indonesia. Let's continue to the next slide. Checklist of mosquito species in Indonesia was published exactly 40 years ago by O'Connor and Sopa as a special publication issued by US NAMRO Unit 2 in Jakarta. This checklist is listed about 456 mosquito species included in 18 genera. One of them is Mansonia that contains 8 species. Adult mosquito of genus Mansonia can be distinguished to another mosquito genera by its unique asymmetrical wing scales. Meanwhile, the larvae have special saw-like structure at the tip of siphon, which is modified for perching submerged parts of aquatic plants to obtain oxygen from the parenchyma tissue. All Mansonia species in Indonesia included in subgenus Mansoniades. Mansonia mosquitoes, widely known as a vector for lymphatic filariasis. 6 out of 8 Mansonia species in Indonesia has incriminated as nocturnal subperiodic lymphatic filariasis in Indonesia. Updated data regarding diversity and distribution of Mansonia mosquito in Indonesia is very important for lymphatic filariasis vector control, considering that elimination of lymphatic filariasis in Indonesia is targeted to be achieved in 2025. This paper aims to deliver update regarding the distribution data of Mansonia mosquitoes in Indonesia, as well as provide the illustrated key for female Mansonia mosquito in Indonesia to assist in identification process for the research or surveillance. This paper was an update for distribution data of Mansonia mosquito in Indonesia based on O'Connor and Sopa publication in 1981. The information about distribution data of species member of Mansonia in Indonesia were summarized from several related literature and research reports of research khusus vector and reservoir in 2015 to 2018. The distribution information is limited only in Indonesia region and excludes Malaysian Borneo and Papua New Guinea. Let's continue to the result. The table shows the checklist of Mansonia species and their distribution in Indonesia. Indonesia region is divided into 7 sub-regions according to the main island or islands. I think it is quite obvious that there are Sumatra, Kalimantan, Java, the Lesser Sunda Island, Sulawesi, Moluccas, and Papua. The check show that corresponding species occur in the particular areas. Yellow cells show the distribution data added by this paper. I will mention the detailed location where the species was collected on the next slide. Green cells show the distribution confirmed by this paper, because distribution of the species in these areas are not confirmed yet, according to O'Connor and Sopa. We will discuss about the checklist from O'Connor and Sopa later. Purple cell indicate that the distribution record of the species has been deleted. I will explain the reason of removing this record in the discussion chapter. This map show new distribution record of Mansonia species in Indonesia, compiled from research report of Rico Spectora in 2015 to 2018. Mansonia annulata has the largest additional area of distribution in Java, the Lesser Sunda Islands, Moluccas, and Papua. Meanwhile, Moluccas is the region with the most additional species, with 4 Mansonia species. This is illustrated key we made based on identification key of Javan mosquitoes Pera malingam 1974. Illustrations were drawn manually based on mosquito specimens stored in biorepository of IVRCRD Salatiga. Mansonia species checklist in this slide is based on O'Connor and Sopa publication. It is was enlisted 8 species, same with our paper, except for species named Mansonia bonewisterae. The latter name was then designated as synonym for Mansonia septembrum data as a valid species name. Another aspect that we update from O'Connor Sopa list are, for the list, first, the list was not included any distribution data in the Lesser Sunda Islands, so it can be considered as a new record for entire the Lesser Sunda Islands. Second, we add distribution occurrence according to literature and research report of Rico Spectora. Now, 4 Mansonia species now distributed in the entire archipelago. Third, we confirm the occurrence of Mansonia species in the location with asterisk signs. It means that the record need confirmation, because the record of specimen were collected from the neighboring country located in the same island. And the last, we remove distribution record of Mansonia papuensis in Moluccas. The reason is record only stated by Brooke and Bonnie Webster in 1947. So Lee et al. In 1988 stated that the record is questionable, because Lee did not find under the publication that stated Mansonia papuensis occur in the Moluccas. So the authors decided to remove the record of Mansonia papuensis in Moluccas. Previous report of Mansonia species occurring in the Lesser Sunda Island published by these authors were not included in O'Connor and Sopa checklist. Record of Mansonia indiana by Bonnie Webster in 1954 was not compiled by O'Connor and Sopa, while 2 another publication were issued after O'Connor and Sopa publication. Records confirmation of Mansonia bonnie and Mansonia indiana I mentioned earlier were obtained from Rico Spectora collection. Mansonia bonnie was born in Sambas and Kayong Utara Regency, West Kalimantan Province, while Mansonia indiana was collected in Merauke, Papua Province. So these 2 species were definitely distributed in Indonesia region. This is a publication reported the occurrence of Mansonia africana in Indonesia. The authors stated that have found relatively large number of Mansonia africana in Sungai Rengit Murni Village, Banyu Asin Regency, in South Sumatra Province. We argued that this is probably misidentification of Mansonia indiana due to their morphological similarity. But of the species have indistinct white strips in the mesonotum and incomplete pale bands on ultrasonics. Another explanation is that Monsonia africana distribution is restricted to tropical Africa. In the last slide, we conclude that Indonesia has 8 species of Monsonia in subgenus Monsonia jazz. The distribution data of Monsonia annulata, Monsonia annulifera, Monsonia bunni, Monsonia indiana, and Monsonia papuensis has been updated. And illustrated care for female Monsonia mosquito is provided in the paper. Thank you for your kind attention. We look forward to your criticism and suggestion for improving the quality of our paper. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. That was our first presentation from Mr. Nugroho. Thank you very much for your great informative and interesting research about mosquito. I think it's important to be research because we all know that mosquito can be spreading any kind of the infectious disease like dengue or filariasis or other aspect. So for your information, in our faculty, we also have a department of parasitology, and some of our researchers or our lecturer have some research in the insect or the vector of the disease like lice or the tick and the mosquito and others insect. So maybe you can collaborating more and make and research together with the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine. So thank you very much for Dr. Nugroho for your great information. Now we are getting to the next speaker. For the second speaker, we would like to invite, wait a minute, we would like to invite Miss Ariana. She is also a lecturer from the Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Gajah Mada University. So for the Dr. Ariana, time is yours. Please, host can play the video.
Thank you, moderator. The title of our session is the duty of glycoconjugate distribution on parotid and submandibular gland of sugar glider. Sugar glider are endemic animal in Indonesia based on morphology and behavior. Sugar glider are not clavici of insectivora, but in omnivorous mammal. In nature, sugar glider eat nectar and insect. With animal are often used at pet, so that the diet of artificial nectar as well as a mixture of water, honey, and supplement with content carbohydrate. Salivary gland are make sugar product of all salivary gland as parotid and submandibular gland has many functions, a limited amount of carbohydrate digest. Salivary consists of protein, glycoprotein, electronic, and water. This research did get primary data for the distribution of conduit cut in the salivary major gland of other and beloved with matter and method. Matter of this parotid and submandibular gland of sugar cracker method tissue processed by paraffin method stain processed by leptin histochemical method with consist of con A, SBA, WBE. The stain result site analyzed on the intensity of lectin reactivity with indicated by presence of brown color or tissue. Result figure 1-4 are lectin histochemical staining of the sugar cracker parotid gland. Figure 1-4, the adenomer parotid gland of con A and WGE lectin staining with not appear of brown color. Figure 10-4, the adenomer and duct of the parotid gland with SBE lectin staining appear the thick brown color. Figure 5-9 are lectin histochemical staining of the sugar cracker submandibular gland. Figure 5, the adenomer with con A lectin staining a weak bone color VA in figure 10-6, the intercalate and interlobar duct gland of con A lectin staining do not appear a brown color. Figure 7-8, the adenomer submandibular gland of WGE and SBE lectin staining were not the afferent of brown color. The parotid gland sugar cracker with lectin staining con A N W D E nitrative reaction initiate that the adomer at duct of the parotid then do not contain glucose and acetin glucosamine VA BA SBA lectin staining had a weak positive reaction indicate that the adomer upon parotid gland constant acetyl galactosamine. The submandibular gland lectin staining with con A V where A weak positive reactive indicate that the adomer submandibular gland contain glucose white white negative reactive double V G E and S B E lectin staining indicated that submandibular gland adomer do not contain acetyl glucosamine and acetyl galactosamine. In conclusion, the parotid gland of sugar glider contain acetyl galactosamine, VA submandibular gland content close. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ariana, for sharing with us topic related glycoconjugate distribution on the sugar glider. It's very interesting research. As we know that sugar glider is one of the most popular exotic pets in the recent years. So, but sometimes when we are in the clinic, we didn't have any kind of background for anatomy or physiology of this exotic small mammal. So maybe based on this research, we'll be giving more information, adding more information about these exotic animals. Thank you very much for Dr. Ariana for sharing the research with all of us. So next we are going to the last presenter for this subsession. So for this, the third topic will be present by, this is my friend, Mr. Denny Setiawibowo. Mr. Denny Setiawibowo will be present the research related Sumatran elephant, the conservation on the Sumatran elephant. So for the Ms. Denny Setiawibowo, the time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I would like to present our study about elephant with the title "The Differences of Body Measurement in Sumatran Elephant on Different Captivity Management and Sex." First of all, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Denny Setiawibowo. I am the doctoral student of the Science Veterinary, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. For the first introduction, elephant is one of the large mammals that live in Indonesia since the ancient times. And Sumatran elephant are listed as the red with the critical endangered status by the IUCN. And for the historically, the Sumatran elephant using for the transport people, lodging operation, cultural ceremonies, and then the, for the tourism reason. In the 1994 until 1998, the government decided to capture all non-viable wild population elephant and elephant that inhabiting production forest. Is it around the 715 wild elephant has been captured and located into the captivity to be trained, and approximately is around 30% of all captured elephants brought to Waikambas. The captivity, elephant captivity, basically there is two types of elephant captivity in Indonesia. There is the semi-captive management, like in the elephant conservation centers in Sumatra, and then the full captive management, like in the zoo. The differences is about the traits. There is the semi-captive has the less space restraint than the zoo, and at least they have a moment in a day to foraging. This is the capture of the photo of the zoo, and then actually the free choice activity. This is in the semi-captive elephant, that FZA improving ability of elephant to explore and interact in a non-restricted way to the natural environment. And the body parameters. Actually, the body size has an important role and influencing aspects such as mating behavior, production, offspring mass, and dominance. And the information of individual body measurement also can be used to medical treatment or intervention to aid conservation efforts to evaluate conservation management in captivity and for studies on the behavior, ecology, and evolution of animals. And the body measurement actually could be estimates the animal weight, display important role to be a marker of body condition score according to management in captivity, especially for a larger species. This problem, the body parameters are such as height, girth, and length usually used to be measured on immobilized animals, and then the body parameters are frequently used to create equation to predict weight of animals. But all of these techniques using the direct body measurement cannot always be properly assessed for the accuracy. So this study was aimed to assess the differentiation of the body measurement of the captive Sumatran elephant in different sex for a female and male, and the different measurement in the captivity for the semi-captive and the captive. And it would be give the information about body measurement to obtain the accuracy of prediction body weight for the conservation reason. The methodology, we using the 4911, and it is adult elephant from the Aceh and Riau. This is the Elephant Conservation Center in Sumatran Island, and from the zoo, which is Gembira Lokasi and Safari Park. This study analyzed using the SPSS software to analyze using the randomized complete block design, RCBD, and to ensure that the data is normally distributed. This is the body measuring of elephant. We use the 6 variable in body length, chest girth, body height, tarsal circumference, and carpal circumference. This is the box plot of body measurement. We could say that there is the average of the body size is same with the median. So it means that the amount of the sample amount of the body size upper and the under the median is same with the average of body size. So we could say if it's the data of body size is normally distributed. And this is the body measurement of 11 different sex and captive management. We could say that the chest girth and body length in the sex factor, body height and tarsal circumference has a different size between male and female Sumatran elephant. And is it because the body growth of male elephant accelerate their growth after the puberty period and continue to gain weight throughout life? It's called postpubertal growth spurt. It makes the body weight of male is twice than the female. And the Sukumar study reported that even the growth pattern of captive born elephant and the elephant which is born in the wild is the different body size. And the captive management, the significant results is body length and tarsal. It's just two variables that has the significant result, and the other parameters are non-significant. It could be the parameter is linear measurement that represent the growth of bones. At the conclusion, this might no equation based on body measurement that could use for an ideal of to all group of elephants such sex, age, or the captivity management. And this result of this study might be give the little information to provide the differences of some parameters in body measurement to increasing the accuracy of the equation that using in the field. So this is the reference. I really thank you for your appreciation and attention. Good afternoon. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. It was the presentation from Mr. Denny Setio Widodo. Thank you very much for your interesting topic. Quote unquote, I say sexy topic because it's related to the conservation, especially on the critically endangered species from our country, elephant Sumatras. So that's all presentation for this session. We are going to the next part, the discussion session. So I will check the chat box for the any participant. If you have any question, please write the answer, the question in the chat box. So I have a question firstly for Mr. Sidik Setyonugroho. For Mr. Nugroho, can you explain more? In Indonesia, we have 8 different species of Mansonia. Is any differences related to the spreading of the disease? I mean, if the what of the one species can be spread different disease or is almost same?
Okay, thank you for the question. Actually, this is the real concern about the species diversity and distribution is the risk factor for spreading of disease. The most important disease for that spread by Mansonia mosquito is lymphatic filariasis, and this disease is really difficult to cure and really difficult to eliminate because in the early stage of its transmission, the symptom is not detectable. So the best practice to eliminate the disease is how we can detect the factor that is mosquito. Actually, lymphatic filariasis is not only transmitted by Mansonia mosquito, but also from Anopheles mosquito, Culex mosquito, and maybe Coccolithidia genus mosquito. And I think this is only part in our struggle or strive to combat the lymphatic filariasis so we can achieve the elimination in 2025. I think it's my answer. So this is the importance of the data. Thank you.
Okay, nice. Thank you very much, Mr. Nugroho.
You're welcome.
So the second question I will ask for the Dr. Ariana. Good afternoon, Dr. Ariana. Can you explain more for us actually what the function or what the function of the glucoconjugates in animals or especially in the sugar gliders? Dr. Ariana? Sorry, maybe Dr. Ariana have some little bit trouble related to the internet. So I will ask my friend, Denny Setia Wibowo, can you explain more, Mr. Denny, what the main factor actually that significant effect on the body size of the elephant? I mean, is related to the nutritional aspect or more for the exercise aspect?
Okay, thank you. Actually, Dr. Alfarisa is my lecturer. I would say thank you to Dr. Alfarisa for the opportunity. Actually, for the correlation between the body size and the nutrition, there is a lot of things that we could correlate it about the body size or of the elephant, actually especially for the captive elephant. There is the differences between the semi-captive elephant and full captive elephant, like in the zoo and in the elephant conservation center. Because in the elephant conservation center, there is in one day there is any time to free range in the forest. So it's just they have time to free range, to foraging in the forest, to choose what they want to eat. But if they eat in the zoo, they just eat what the keeper given. So this is the differences that significantly maybe to give some effect to the nutrition and something else. Maybe this is my answer.
Yes.
Actually,
another question we have. Question from Dr. Woro, and Dr. Woro asking for to Dr. Denny Setia Wibowo.
Yes.
Dr. Woro asks, could you briefly explain the statistical analysis that you are employing and what the obstacle?
For the statistical analysis, I'm using the SPSS. Actually, I just doing the random block analysis because there is the distribution of the sample actually for the age is didn't normal. You know what? I choose the elephant. I cannot choose the elephant with same age because we grow human and elephant growing in the same. I think in the same pattern. So you know, in the same pattern. So the elephant could live in until the 70 years old. So we just put any sample in the elephant conservation center and in the zoo, but we choose the adult one, which is more than 15 years. But because the range of the age is have the variation, big variation. So I choosing the random block analysis to give the representative data. So I just wanna there is a different significance or not between the body measurement or body size in the every variable. In every variable between the in the sex or the captive management. In this statistical analysis, they showing that the different significant differences in the sex factor, female and male, because there is any growth spurt in the male, so the male just have the weight more than 2 times that the female. That's why the female and male give the significant differences. But for the captivity, by the statistical analysis, they do not show the big differences or this. They didn't show the significant differences. But but I believe that there is the differences because of the food that they give in every captivity. But yeah, the data by statistical, maybe we should doing in the young elephant or something like that for the next research. Okay, thank you.
Great explanation for Mr. Denny. Thank you very much, Dr. Woro,
yes,
for your asking.
You're welcome.
From Thailand, Dr. Woro.
Thank you, Dr. Ansari.
Well, I hope your Mr. Denny research will be conduct smoothly or running well, because I know there are any difficulties or obstacles related to restricted permission from the
yes, of course.
Performer. So yes, I'm understanding. So thank you very much.
I really appreciate
Dr. Ariana.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, Dr. Ariana, can you hear me? So maybe Dr. Ariana still have anything problem related. Dr. Ariana, good afternoon.
Morning.
Yeah. Can you explain more, Dr. Ariana, what the function of glucoconjugates in the animals? The function of glucoconjugates in the animals, Dr. Ariana.
Conjugates. They are carbohydrate with bone with protein.
Oh.
In cell, carbohydrate can into the cell, saya kan pakai bahasa Indonesia aja.
Okay, no problem, Dr. Anna, please.
Seperti ke dalam sel itu kan kita nggak masukkan ke karbohidrat masuk ke dalam sel kan, kita harus dibantu sama protein. Harus dibindingkan. Nah itu maksudnya harus tak gini. Kita melihat satu kelenjarnya itu, kita ingin tahu kandungannya itu, yang karbohidratnya itu, ya isinya sama enggak antara hewan satu dan hewan lainnya. Kan seperti dietnya saja, pakannya.
Okay. Yes, I can get. Understand your explanation, Dr. Ariana. So, sugar glider is one of the most favorite exotic pets, and based on my experience, sometimes we have any cases related to improper husbandry, because Dr. Ariana say that sugar glider is insectivora and nectarivora, but sometimes we also give like fruits or vegetables, so it will be giving some problem in the next day. Okay. So thank you, for that's our presentation for the second session, Dr. Ariana, then Dr. Denny Setyowinugroho, Sitik Setyowinugroho, and Denny Setyowibowo. Thank you very much for all speakers the second session.
Thank you.
Now we will going to the next session, the third session. In this part, we also have three another speakers. The first one will be presented by Miss Yunita Vera Rahmawati. The second presenter will be presented by Mr. Yoga Putra Aliani. Yes, then the last one will be presented by Ayunda Bahana Ilham Perdamaian. So for the first our speakers in this session, Miss Yunita Vera Rahmawati, time is yours.
Good afternoon, all ladies and gentlemen, and all veterinary enthusiasts. I would like to say thank you for coming in my presentation. It's great to see you all. I am Yunita Vera Rahmawati from Department of Biology Education, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Science of Jakarta State University. In this opportunity, I will share to our research about diversity and distribution of mollusca in the intertidal zone of Ngelambur Beach, Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta. Ngelambur Beach is one of the rocky beaches in the south of Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta. It has a basic material in the form of sandy corals with sand that is more dominant in choosing the type of coral. The physical condition of this beach has steep cliffs, scar hills, and white sand. The intertidal zone on the Ngelambur Beach is divided into three subzones, which are regularly by different biological and physical factors, namely the upper, middle, and lower zones. Some substrate types in the intertidal area on Ngelambur Beach are sandy and some are rocky. Organisms found on rocky soil face intense physicochemical conditions during tidal change from upper to lower intertidal zones, such as temperature, salinity, pH, and oxygen, which occur perpendicular to the coast. Mollusca are one of the many organisms found on these beach, animals that have the ability to bury themselves and tend to have slippery and heavy shells. Mollusca have important roles in coastal ecosystem, food webs, algae feeders, detritivores, and deposit feeders. The process in an ecosystem can take on the diversity of the organisms that make it up. Measuring species richness and diversity across different habitats are a useful tool for planning action to conserve marine biodiversity. This use a systematic plot transect method by placing a 1 × 1 m² plot systematically along the transect, then determine 2 observation stations randomly, then lay the plots with a distance of 5 m each in each plot. Observation were made of all mollusca, including those at the bottom of the substrate. For animals embedded in the substrate, a dig to a depth of 5 until 10 centimeters. Collecting data for mollusca were carried out directly at the research location, namely recording species, morphological characteristic, a number of species in each plot. After collecting photos were collected, the identification of mollusca based on morphological characteristics in the form of a shape, a color, and a characteristic shell. Mollusca are identified to the lowest possible taxonomy level using the K taxonomy identification and from the WOM database. The density of marine gastropod were determined as a number of individuals divided meter square using Shannon-Wiener index. And then the species evenness index was calculated using Pileo's evenness index. And then frequency of incident was estimated using the below equations. Aditya and Malacostraca, belonging to 13 families and 20 species, were found in upper to lower and intertidal zone at Ngelabur Pits. Gastropod found in 50 species, 4 species of Bivalvia, and 1 species of Malacostraca. Tarsipucastanum is the most abundant species in the upper and lower intertides, while Thais tisoti murisida is the most abundant in the middle zone. The index of Shannon Winner mollusca diversity ranges from 1.920 until 2.524, where the highest diversity is in the upper zone and low diversity is in the lower zone. In general, the average diversity of mollusca is 2.263, which indicates medium category. The evenness index of the species range from 0.864 until 0.92, with an average value of 0.890, and so high evenness. Murisida are reported to be widely distributed inhabiting coastal and marine habitats. Most of the Murisida are seen clustered between rocks, crevices. This behavior is to ensure water and humidity conservation during the dry season at a low tide. This can prevent damage to marine gastropod systems such as a respiration, an excretion, and a digestion. Such characteristics help the Murisida to be resilient in poor ecosystem. The diversity index in the medium category shows a fairly good balance between the number of species and the total individuals of each species. Meanwhile, the high evenness index of mollusca found in the research location indicates that the distribution of individuals in each species is evenly distributed in a community and no particular species dominates. The abundance of mollusca depends on the availability of foods such as detritus and macroalga, and they prefer habitats that are protected from currents, waves, and direct sunlight. And then the addition, the abundance of mollusca at the research location was supported when data collection was carried out during the rainy season, where the input of organic matter increased and the area of organic bodies increase. The area of water bodies increase, among others, by the formation of floodplains, so most of the members reproduce. A total of 3 clades of mollusca, gastropod, bivalvia, and malacostraca, belonging to 13 families and 20 species, were found from upper to lower and intertidal zone. The upper intertidal zone was recorded to have the highest diversity and unevenness index compared to the middle and lower zones. It can be concluding that the diversity index in the study location is categorized as medium and its evenness is high. Tarsipucastanum from Murisida is the most dominant species found in the upper and middle zones, while Thais tisoti dominates in the lower zone. And here is some pictures during the data collection our research. And this is our reference that our use. Thank you and have a nice day.
Great, thank you very much for Ms. Rahmawati. This was the presentation related diversity and distribution of the mollusca in the Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta. Great information. And for the next presenters, we have another speakers, Mr. Yoga Putra Aliani. So for the video from Mr. Aliani, the time is yours.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the time that given to me. I'm so honored today to present my research. My name is Yoga Putra Aliani, and I'm from Biology Department of Yogyakarta State University. My research is about invertebrates community similarity in Lambor Interpretar Zone in Indonesia. Lambor Beach is located in Gunung Kidul, Indonesia. This has a coral rocky topography, but currently Lambor has experienced some exploitation like a tourist object, snorkeling area, and also marine life hunting. Lambor has various invertebrate species. The intertidal zone at Lambor has a various type of substrates such as sands, rocks, and coral fragments. In the intertidal zone, there is a reciprocal relationship between taxon such as algae, which can affect the existence of macroinvertebrates. The species have specific and unique habitat specification. So the study aim is to investigate the similarity of invertebrates in Lambor intertidal zone. Now we talk about material and methods. This research was conducted from ages to September 2020. In this research, we use pH meter, thermometer, salinity meter, and also plot. And now about the methods. The transect used in this study is ComTransect with 4 research stations. ComTransect are suitable for use in intertidal zone. Its area of this research is made of a transect with length of 100 meters, and its transect is divided into 10 plots. The distance of every plot is 5 meters. Invertebrates observation were carried out by visually, including invertebrates in the substrate, as well as those that attach in rock. To determine the area of algae cover, we also use plot method like in the invertebrates. And in statistical analysis, similarity results are visualized in dendrogram. To make it, we use PAS5 application. Now, talk about the results and discussion. In this research, we found 5 invertebrate spilla with total 423 individuals. The mollusca is the most common phylum found in this research with total 341 individuals or 74.23% of total individuals found. Its station in this research have different ecological parameters like pH, temperature, and salinity. Based on ecological parameters, station 1, which is on the west side of the research, has the highest pH. In station 1 are rocky cliff from coral. You know that rocks that contain calcium carbonate in this station can increase the pH of the water to more than 7, of course. The station 4 location is get direct seawater flow. All stations have their own ecological parameter characteristic that is so unique. And now, this is about the algae cover. Dijania adherens is the most dominant algae in our research. And the biggest algae cover in this station is station 4. The station 4 is open area. The large area covered by algae is due to the large size of the rock that provide a good assessment for the algae. And now about the similarity of invertebrates community among the research station based on this coefficient. The similarity of invertebrates community is divided into 4 clusters. The station 4 is from its our cluster. It's because the station 4, we found phylum Nemertea that only occur in station 4. It's make the station 4 creates its our clusters. Based on our research, species and the algae cover will affect the difference in habitat characteristic. The types of invertebrates that live are different. Algae morphology can affect the type of invertebrates. Certain algae form will support certain species. And you can see in the invertebrates community have the highest similarity between the station 1 and station 3. The algae cover is quietly similar. There is 50 and 46%. The algae cover is greatly affect the similarity of the invertebrates in Lambor intertidal zone. Several factors such as pH, water temperature, and salt content can affect the existence of invertebrate species. But in this study, the algae cover area had the more effect on similarity of invertebrates. Now you can see that this is the invertebrate similarity in habitat use based on Jacquard coefficient. Based on invertebrate similarity in habitat use, it's known that there are four major brands. The cluster from similar habitat use for a taxon. The cluster that is formed can consist of several villa, which shown that the use of habitat between villa influence its others. The dendrograms of similarity in habitat use shown that a species can live in certain environment, several species originating from different villa, you know, can have the ability to live in the same environment, even though their needs will be different. And the conclusion based on this research, in abiotic factor, such as water pH, water temperature, salt content, and biotic factors such as the area of algae cover. Difference in invertebrate community at its research station due to difference in the area of algae cover. There are variation in the use of the habitat for its invertebrates at the Ngelambor, at Ngelambor to form clusters. Our thanks to TIPA FMIPA UNJ, which have facilitated funding for this research. This is our reference. And thank you for your attention. Good afternoon.
This was presentation for our second speakers. Another interesting topic from our friend from the Yogyakarta State University, and Mr. Yoga have a focus research related, I think similar or related with the Miss Rahmawati in the biology department. So thank you very much for sharing us the interesting topic. Now I would there will be Mr. Ayunda Bahana Ilham Perdana. Ayunda, times is yours.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Ayunda Bahana Ilham from Gama Chicken Research Team, Laboratory of Genetic Ability, Faculty of Biology, Universitas Gadjah Mada. Well, our first author is from Laboratory of Animal Structure Development, and our third author is Satiman, Pelung Chicken Farmer, Magetan, East Java. Today, we will to present our result about the plumage color stability in implant Pelung Chicken. So, why we choose this research is first, Indonesia is among world's largest chicken breed biodiversity spot. Indonesia has 25 local chicken breed, where Cemani, Sumatra, Ketu, Kape, Nunukan, Pelu are the most studied breed. Otherwise, Indonesia is also has exotic chicken, both commercial live, broiler and layer, and ornamental breed, such as Serama, something like that, are sold freely. We can purchase imported chicken from market and then breed in our home. So, this action is made a genetic integration and inbreeding depression are the major threat for the native Indonesian chicken breed. Uncontrolled and interbreed treatment genetic identity of local chicken breed. So when local chicken have mating with commercial lion and other exotic breed, so their children will be a hybrid, so the genetic identity will be decreased. Otherwise, the inbreeding depression will be higher in local chicken breed because relatively small size population and some of chicken sausage balloon. The farmer have tendency to breed good balloon with their relative. To date, there are limited studies related to the genetic and phenotypic marker of intercation and inbreeding depression in Indonesian chicken. So this study aimed to investigate the effect of inbreeding to the phenotype of balloon chicken. So we want to explore what is the difference between inbreeding chicken with non-inbreeding chicken. So the objective is to investigate the plumage color stability in inbred balloon chicken. We purchase a balloon directly from Cianjur, and then we conduct a full ship breeding. So the spring will meet with their brother and sister, so on. And into we have 5 generation of breeding. So this is the result. First, the first generation is similar to one type. The male have black and red plumage color, and the female is brown. Similarly, in the second generation, red and black and brown female. We found a difference in the third generation. So we have 2 types of chicken color. This is silver and brown. Female silver and female light brown. So the genotype is brown and rich. In the fourth generation, we have all progeny with brown color. And the 5th generation is similar to the 4th generation. We only have brown color, very light brown color, which is different from the 3rd generation with the dark brown color. So the discussion. To the our knowledge, this is the first report about plumage stability in plumage breeding for 5 generations. And we confirm the theory of dominant model of plumage color. So the wild type black with red secondary plumage, which is the superscript plus was dominant upon the brown, the dark brown, and the light brown. The superscript B and the superscript BC and bridge with the silver color. This silver color. So the wild type plumage color was eliminated in the 5th generation after what they inbreeding in small flock. This is because of the segregation of LU. With along with recessive plumage color could have inbreeding division. So this is our theory, which is the along with recessive plumage color didn't have dominant color, which is after the inbreeding depression. So below is considered a specific local chicken, which is really recognized by its long growing character. As we know, buffalo have the very special character. So, buffalo has the marker of intrication by its growing. When we crossbreed buffalo with commercial line, their progeny didn't have any long growing character. So, but if we in this research, balloon inbreeding balloon still have long growing character. Then balloon exists with many plumage color type. Other research in Jiangjur exploring the many type of plumage. They found a brown balloon, white balloon, and black balloon. However, is red and black plumage. Has possibility to carry broad or rich plumage allele. Unlike Kedu and simple chicken breed, which recognized by its standard plumage color. There's blue color in gentle plumage and black or brown color in black kedu or brown kedu chicken plumage. So we can say kedu or without their brown or black or gentle chicken without blue color. Acknowledgement. The author would like to acknowledge Ministry of Research and Higher Education for providing the research grant. And the author also would like to thank the University Fund, PIAT, Universitas Gajah Mada for providing the breeding facility. Okay, here's the reference cited in this picture. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a great presentation from Mr. Ayuda from the Gamma Chicken Faculty of the Biology, Gajah Mada University. Thank you for your sharing and innovative, interesting explanation. Now we are going on the discussion session. So in this session, I will check the question on the checkbox. Now we have several questions in my checkbox. The first one coming from, the first one coming from DST Putri Amartya, asked to Miss Yunita Vera Rahmawati. That was very interesting research. And I have two questions. The first one, as far as I know, Mollusca Malacostrata is the largest of the six class of crustaceans. Why you include Malacostrata into Mollusca? The second one, among several diversity index, why Shannon Wiener index chosen for this research? So for Miss Yunita Vera Rahmawati, please answer the question.
Okay, hello, do you hear me?
Yes, clear, Mr. Yunita.
Okay. Yes, thank you, Mr. Alfariza Nulurozi. Okay, thank you for the question. It is a very good questions. I think, okay, number one is about Malacostrata. Okay, I do really sorry, because this is a typo. I will write not Malacostrata, but I will write Murisida. So the my presentation I wrote a total of 3 classes of mollusca is gastropod, bivalvia, and malacostraca. Sorry, I'm typo. So we must write a muricida, not a malacostraca. Thank you for the correction, Miss Desti. And then the second about what is it? Silent winner, yeah. Silent winner, I think is measures uncertainty in order to determine if a community is diverse. So why I choose the silent winner? Because the measure is near to be fixed to determine the community in the locations. Thank you.
So in the question, the next I have a question for Mr. Yoga. I have a curiosity why this research conduct in the lumber pits. I mean, why didn't you choose the another pits more popular like Sunda pits, for example, and other pits? Just curiosity, my curiosity.
Okay, thank you for the question for Mr. Alfariza. Yeah, of course, in Gunung Kidul there is a lot of pits like Ngelambor, like Sunda and others pits in Gunung Kidul. But Ngelambor is unique because there's not a lot of research in Ngelambor, and also in Ngelambor they had several exploitation like marine animal hunting, like tourist recreation and others. So we are so curious to doing research in that location.
Okay, thank you very much for sharing. In several years ago, I have a question. Identification of mollusca related to disease in the cattle. I find the Gunung Kidul have a higher prevalence of trematoda, or we call liver flux disease. Maybe Miss Yunita or Miss Yoga can understand liver flux disease is one disease can infect the cattle spread out by the mollusca, and the prevalence in the Gunung Kidul is little bit higher compared with the others district in Yogyakarta, maybe related to the higher population of the mollusca in that area, but I don't know the risk factor. Then for the Mr. Ayuda, I want to know how to identify the palung chicken. It's enough based on the phenotype characteristic, or we must collect the sample and check based on the genotype characteristic. I mean, using the DNA aspect. Mr. Ayuda, can you hear me? Mr. Ayuda, I will repeat my question once again for Mr. Ayuda. Can you explain more about the characteristic of chicken palung? I mean, how we can identify the chicken palung is enough for based on the phenotype characteristic, or we need more detail on the genetic methods? Mr. Ayuda, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, yes.
So we can identify the palung chicken by its crowing sound. So chicken has very long crowing vocalization like that. and Palung chicken has a bigger body appearance. So if we see a very big palung, we can if we see a big chicken, it can be a palung like that. We didn't need a genetic testing for differentiate palung from other chicken breed. Thank you.
Great. I think it's interesting research topic, how to maintain or selecting the good breed of our native chicken or kampung chicken. One of our specific breed is the palung, which was have a large or big size body. I think interesting topic from all of speaker in the third session. Thank you very much, Mr. Yoga, Mr. Ayuda, and Miss Yunita for your explanation for all of us. Yes. Now,
this is one question again.
Oh yes, in the chat box.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay. F1 palung. So I get the F1 from crossbreeding.
And then you combine what chicken with the different breeds?
Yes. So we crossbreed along with broiler, mid-type chicken. So the chill, the offspring is hybrid. The hybrid is didn't same with along. So there. They didn't have long crowing sound, so they're just like berkokok sangat pendek, not like pelung. So the vocalization is different, so like that.
So you crossbreed the pelung and the broiler chicken. Which one the male and which one the female?
Male pelung with female broiler.
Okay, so commercial broiler chicken, right?
Yes, right.
Oh, nice. Because as far as I know, the commercial broiler chicken, we call it commercial because the reproductive organ is not as good as the breed or the
yeah.
I mean, yeah, because maybe I just giving your suggestion, maybe you can choose broiler, but on the commercial, not commercial stock, but on the breeding stock, parental stock, that's right. In the parental stock, have a pure breed, have a characteristic still same with the pure line of the broiler chicken. Okay, just suggestion.
You. Yes. Okay,
thank you very much, Mr. Ayuda, Mr. Yoga, and Mr. Yunita. Yeah. Now we are going to the fourth session. Similar with the session before, in this part we have also, I'm sorry, not three, but just two speakers. The first one will be presented by Ms. Lulu Aulia, then followed by our second speaker will be presented by Mr. Arvendi Rahmajadi. So for the first one, I would like to invite Ms. Lulu Ul Aulia. Time is yours.
The Honorable Mr. and Madam Speakers, distinguished guests, fellow students, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening. Before the presentation begins, allow me to introduce myself. I'm Lulul Aulia from Marine Study Club, Gajah Mada University. I would like to present our paper entitled Gastropod Diversity in Intertidal Zone of Porok Beach, Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta, Indonesia. So, Indonesia is a country with a very high level of biodiversity characterized by the ecosystem, the types in the ecosystem, and the germ plasms inside each type. Porok Beach is located at the western regions of Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta. This beach serves as a research station for the Faculty of Biology, Gajah Mada University. The structure of the Porok Beach intertidal zone consists of sand and dead coral with algae. gastropods are the mollusk class with the most abundant number of species and high diversity. The structure of the gastropod community is influenced by many factors, such as competitions, food availability, types of substrates, water temperatures, and salinity. Gastropods is from gastro or stomach, and podos means feet, are cell mollusks that mobilize with their stomach muscles, making their stomach their feet. So the aim of the research is to study the biodiversity of gastropods mollusks in the intertidal zone of Porak Beach, Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta. We conducted this study in the intertidal zone of Porak Beach, Gunung Kidul, Yogyakarta in October 17, 2020. Porak Beach is characterized by fine sand dominated by dead coral with algae along the coastline. Therefore, we found that the algal community was less abundant than usual, possibly correlating with the algal crops bought by local villagers before Nerby. So, there are the materials and tools that we use. Specimens were collected along the intertidal zone of Porak Beach using purposive random sampling. Specimens then preserved and identified using FIO, West Central Pacific Volume 1, worms, and compendium seashell. The result of this research shown that there are 8 families of gastropods found at the beach, as presented in Table 1. The only gastropod species from the Aplysidae we found was Aplysia sp. Aplysia sp have a length of 7 cm with the dominant body color of brown with a black pattern. Its body is soft and covered in a clear mucus. Generally, Aplysidae have two pairs of tentacles on the head, lateral porapoida and defense gland. The gastropod species from Conidae was Conus coronatus, Conus lividus, and Conus flavidus. Conus coronatus were 2.5 cm in size and dominated by brown and black patterns. This species has a light color shell with plush pink hues and brown dots. Conus coronatus has a wider aperture at the base and at the shoulder. Conus flavidus has a shell color without white spots and sculpture on the body wall, sometimes has spiral grooves. Conus lividus is approximately 1.5 cm in size with a dark brown shell color. The color on the body wall is darker than the color in the spiral. Conus lividus has the last borer color of olive green to brownish yellow. The only gastropod species from Tokidae family was Monodonta labio, which is about 1.5 cm in size with a brown shell, predominantly black pattern. This type of gastropod can be found from the intertidal zone of deep sea. The characteristic of this family is their large pyramidal conical or round shell. Tokidae members generally have a flat bottom around to square aperture and do not have siphonal canal. The only gastropods from Neritidae was Neritica albicilla with a size of up to 2 cm. The color of the shell is brown with a black hue covering part on the dorsal. Neritidae are herbivores with solid shells, globular in shape, and have a smooth surface. Members of this family have a low spire and aperture shape like a crescent moon. The gastropod species from Turbinidae was Turbo bruneus. The size of the species found reached 2.9 cm. turbo brunels are known herbivores gastropod that consume algae and live on rocky and rocky coastal area. While the gastropod species from the Columbellidae was Columbella and Mitrella sp. Columbella sp have a body length up to 1 centimeter and a brown shell with black pattern. Columbella are distributed in Indonesia. Also, members of the same genera are distributed in East Atlantic and Mediterranean regions. Species from the family Volutidae found only one species with a brown shell pattern with black spot around the spire and bodywork. The upper tarsopod is generally long and the siphonal canal wide. For habitat, these species of family are commonly found on sandy or muddy areas with an ideal water temperature at 24.17 to 25.49 degrees Celsius. They can move quickly and bury all part of their body. Their food resources are small invertebrates as well as other mollusks. So we can conclude that there are 8 families of gastropod found in intertidal zone of Porok Beach, consisting of 10 species. We found 3 species from family Quenidae and only 1 species each from the rest of the family. Thank you for your attention.
Great, thank you very much, Ms. Aulia, for your informative and interesting presentation related to diversity of gastropod in the Gunung Kidul sub-district. Thank you very much for sharing with us. Now, the other speakers will be present by Dr. Arvendi, my friend. Dr. Arvendi, can you hear me? Okay, Dr. Arvendi will be present a topic related to research. So for the Dr. Arvendi, time is yours.
Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to say thank you for the chance that had been given to me. It is a great honor for us that we can share about our research project in the Sea Cafe 2021. On behalf of our research team, I want to share about sialic acid glycan histochemistry in respiratory mucosa of mucoman balfinch fat, or Baraluxus hermaphroditus. This research conducted by myself, Afin Kambajedi, Heri Wijayanto, and Muroda Rwendo from Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. Musang luwak, or Paradoxurus hermaphroditus, is one of the important wildlife that play roles in being a reservoir for several diseases, such as rabies, acute respiratory syndrome, avian influenza virus, parvovirus, and coronavirus. Coronavirus is virus from the Coronaviridae and Ordo Nidoviridae families. This virus causes infection of the respiratory and digestive tract in animal and human, and causes death, such as in the case of the outbreak of severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS, and Middle East respiratory syndrome, or MERS. The current global condition with the outbreak of the new type of coronavirus, or SARS-CoV-2, raises concern that CFET, whether wild or kept, as intermediate hosts. Supporting information about disease is still minimal and encourages researchers to conduct research that aim to find out about the glycemic protein, glycemic profile in the histology of the CFET respiratory tract as a potential property of the coronavirus receptor. This study used a specimen in the form of a respiratory tract of the 3 different sexes of the adult CFET cats from Yogyakarta and Lampung. Sample has been collected in advance for previous research. This research has obtained a certificate of ethical clearance from the Ethical Commission of the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada. The sample were collected, perfused, and then microtechnical processing to produce paraffin blocks. Paraffin blocks were sliced for micron using a rotary microtome, and sample were stained with abipassin to histochemical lectin, wet germ agglutinin, or VGA, Macassia amorensis lectin 2, or MAL2, and Sambucus nigra agglutinin SNA. Lectin histochemistry were employed to detect N-acetyl-D-glucosamine and sialic acid, alpha-2.3 and acetylglucosamine or galactose respectively. The CFET trachea has several rare consecutively from the inside out, namely the mucosa, submucosa, hyaline cartilaginous layer, and tunica adventitia. The mucosa layer consists of the epithelium, lamina propria, and the invisible muscularis mucosa. The epithelium of the trachea in Seyfert is a ciliated pseudo-stratified columnar containing the Golgi cell and the basal cells. Based on this observation, the same thing was also found in several species, such as dog, mongoose, donkey, and camel. The columnar cells are oval in shape with a dark cell nucleus at the basement with the Golgi cells scattered along the lining. This section is part of mucus producing as a protective agent in the respiratory tract against the infective agent. The lamina propria part of the civet trachea consists of the connective tissue consisting of collagen, elastic fiber, and reticular fiber, as is found in cat and goats. There is a seromucous gland in the submucosa layer. Tracheal mucus in ferrets as in dog, and the other carnivore, which is present in the external part of the hyaline cartilage. Tunica adventitia layer consists of the connective tissue, which is domestic in domestic animal and aves are all the same. Based on the result of the hematoxylin eosin staining, staining was done again using ABPAS, Asian blue and periodic assessive, to see the production of mucin, acidity, or glycoconjugate in certain organ. The tracheal epithelium of the civet was stained blue, which saw a positive AB reaction and on its goblet cell. This indicates that there is a glycoconjugonic acid produced by these cells. Suspected acidic sugar residue or sialic acid on the mucin glycoprotein produced by these cells. Goblet cells among the tracheal epithelial cells contain neutral with the black arrowhead and mixture with the yellow arrowhead. Mucous substance as indicated by ABPAS in magenta and purple color, respectively. Gland submucosa contain mixture neutral and acid muco substances show with the red arrowhead. The indication in the basis for proving the potential presence of the certain receptor that have a chemical composition containing sialic acid. AB staining positively reaction are also abundant in the granular seromucus, which is serous localized in the crystal plasma of the gland. The function of this gland is to secrete mucin or glycoprotein into the tracheal mucosa. The presence of the acid glycoprotein contained in the secret gives a high possibility that the surface of the tracheal epithelium is coated with the structure of acid glycoprotein, one of which is thought to be a receptor for coronavirus. This is the same demonstrated by mucus secretion in the digestive tract, where the presence of the mucin contributes to protection against microorganisms, toxin, and lubrication of mechanical protection from the intestine. Laboratory investigates different lactin bonds during the epithelial differentiation to show sugar residues, for example, alpha-D-galactose group, alpha-L-fucosyl groups, and N-acetyl-glucosamine, which are present in the basal, spinose, and conifer cell layer sequentially. The respiratory tract tissue has been extensively investigated regarding lactin that are used as a marker in the specific subpopulation of the cell or secret production of supernormal cells or a pathological condition. This is the picture of trachea with SNA alpha 2.6 gal moderate reactivity intensity genus in the cilia on the surface of the tracheal epithelial cells, shown with the red arrowhead. This is also trachea stained with the MAL2 alpha 2.2 gal with no reactivity in the tracheal epithelial cells. This is using the VGA galnat glycerolic acid with strong intensity denoted in the cilia and basolateral of the tracheal epithelial cells, shown with the red arrowhead, and the moderate intensity of in the Golgi cell with the black one. This picture shows that for the SNA alpha 2.6 gal, weak reactivity in the cilia of bronchus epithelial cells. In the other side, with abipes staining, the goblet cells are contain mixture mucous substance. This one is a staining with mild to alpha 2.2 gal with no reactivity in the bronchus epithelial cells and moderate in the alveoli or pneumocytes with show with the red arrowhead. And from this picture in the left is staining using the SN alpha 2.6 gal, which is a weak reactivity in the cilia of the bronchiolus epithelial cells. Compared to the right one, is using the mild to alpha 2.3 gal with strong intensity in the bronchiolus epithelial cells. The brief results, galactican was produced by the tracheal epithelial cells, goblet cells, and decorated the cilia combined with acetylic acid alpha 2.6 gal, but not acetylic acid alpha 2.3 gal. The cilia of the bronchus experienced with weak alpha 2.6 gal, whereas the surface epithel of bronchioles and alveoles strongly performed by acetylic acid alpha 2.6 gal. Conclusion of this study is the acetylic acid distribution on the surface of the respiratory tract of the common tonsillate or Paradoxurus hemaproditus is potential as the binding receptor for the virus. This is the acknowledgement for the study funding program by the Directorate of Research, Universitas Gadjah Mada. This is the reference that we use, and thank you very much.
Great. It was a great presentation. Thank you very much, Mr. Arvendi Rahmajadi, for sharing your topic with all of us. Now we have another two speakers, but we will change the plan. So another two speakers will be combined, join us with this session. So I would like to invite our next speakers, Ms. Anissa Proponingrat. So for the Ms. Anissa Proponingrat, time is yours.
Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Anissa Proponingrat. I'm the first author of this paper. I would like to share with you about the paper entitled The Cytotoxic Activity of Pine Needles Ethanolic Extract of Pinus mercusi on HeLa cell lines. And this is what my research has been looking at. So let's get started. Cancer is a complex disease that characterized by aberrant cell growth and invasion of neighboring cells and tissues. This disease is one of the leading causes of mortality and morbidity globally. International Agency for Research on Cancer, IARC, and 9.6 million deaths occurred in 2018. And it is predicted that the incidence will increase to 29.5 million by 2040. To date, common cancer treatments include surgery, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy is very costly. And certain treatments such as the chemotherapy can cause serious side effects on patients. Discovering efficacious anti-cancer agents with lower side effects is a key challenge. Some literature mentions that certain plant compounds show anti-cancer activity and are considered safer with less unexpected harmful effects. More than 60% of the current anti-cancer drugs are derived from natural products. Pinus mercusi is one of the pine plant species. This plant is native to Southeast Asia, including Indonesia. In Asia, the pine trees are usually used as a folk remedy for dermatological and topical ailments,
gastrointestinal disorders, inflammation, ulcers, itching, and to treat snake bites. The pine genus is well known as a source of antioxidants, especially phenolic compounds such as procyanidins and other flavonoids and vinolic acids. However, there are still no reports regarding the anti-cancer potential of Pinus medicosi needles, so that this study was aimed to determine the cytotoxic effect of Pinus medicosi needle extract on HeLa cervical cancer cell lines. This research began with pine leaves or the needles extraction based on maceration method using 96% ethanol. And in this research, we called the extract as PMNE. Next, we performed a cytotoxicity test based on MTT assay. This assay involves a colorimetric reaction of MTT reagent with a dehydrogenase enzyme present in living cells. So, the HeLa cells were grown in 96 well plates and treated with PMNE with a serial concentration of 400, 800, and 1600 microgram per milliliters for 24, 48, and 72 hours of incubation times. The result in the form of absorbance was spatial at 600 nanometers using a microplate reader. Then we calculate the cytotoxicity and determine the IC50 value using linear regression analysis. MTT results of this research revealed that treated HeLa cells cytotoxicity increased gradually with the increasing of PMNE concentration and incubation time. The highest inhibition of HeLa cells was found at 48 hours incubation of 1600 microgram per milliliters PMNE with cytotoxicity of 94.21%. PMNE showed IC50 values ranging from 1021.52, 542.52, and 1374.18 microgram per milliliters at 24, 48, and 72 hours respectively. PMNE exhibits a growth inhibiting effect time and dose dependently with greater potency at 48 hours of therapy. This suggests that PMNE triggers cellular processes that cause inhibition of cell proliferation and induce cell death. As in other pine species, Pinus medicosi is thought to contain procyanidins, which are reported to inhibit cells proliferation and induced apoptosis in some cancer cells without any significant effect on normal cells. Procyanidins isolated from another plant like Uncaria tomentosa had been shown to be cytotoxic in AGS human gastric adenocarcinoma and SW620 human colon adenocarcinoma cells. On another hand, Pinus masoniana bark proanthocyanidins were reported to initiate apoptosis and prevent cell migration of A2780 human ovarian cancer cells. Based on the results of this study, we conclude that Pinus medicosi needles has an anti-proliferative effect on HeLa cells depending on the dose and treatment time. The study also provides preliminary information on the potential of Pinus mercusi needles extract as a candidate for anti-cancer agents. And further research is needed to explore the underlying mechanism of action and the efficacy of this plant as a chemo prevention agent. So that's all my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention. See you again.
Great, thank you very much for Ms. Anissa sharing with us relating her topic extract herbal for cytotoxic effect for the research looking for treatment the cancer. I think it's important research because we already know that cancer have highly mortality. And thank you very much for your interesting and informative presentation. Now we are going to the last presenter for this session. I would like to invite Dr. Arya Ika Septana to present his topic. For Dr. Arya, time is yours.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to say thanks for my chance to be present in of my paper in the first of HFS. It's great to meet all of you in online conference, and I hope all of you in healthy condition, and we hope this pandemic will be finished in fast. In this opportunity, I would like to present our paper about the effect of probiotic and sodium deformate on productivity and immunity of broiler chicken. My name is Arya Ika Septana, and my group, we are from Department of Pharmacology, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada, Yogyakarta, Indonesia. First, I will explain to all of you that broiler chicken is the largest industry in the world. This is in the term of production to meat for human consumption. The productivity is the main and the most indicators in terms of successful broiler maintenance. Before 2018, antibiotic growth promoter, or we can say AGP, in the feed is normally used by a broiler farmer. It used to control bacteria in the digestive tract, so it can reduce the mortality. Gastrointestinal disease can be a serious problem in the production of poultry. But start from January 1st, 2018, AGP banned by Indonesia government. So all of broiler farmer and broiler chicken industry cannot use AGP again. This policy related to antimicrobial resistant issue caused by antibiotic growth promoter use. Some of research said that organic acid and mineral salt are very commonly used to suppress gastrointestinal disorder and improve productivity. Probiotic also are another candidate that serve as a substitute for AGP in addition to betabiotic and other feed supplement. From this condition, we should make some research from this component, organic compound, mineral, and probiotic, so we can develop and move quickly to find a replacement for AGP. In our study, aim to examine the effect of mineral and probiotic and the combination on productivity and immunity of broiler. Our research was conducted in April to November 2020 and located in Laboratory Animal Research, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Gadjah Mada, and some sample analysis we are located in Disease Investigation Center, Wates. We use a 60 ml day old chick of broiler chop strain were used in this study and kept in the cage with litters. For treatment, we used the sodium deformat with the dose of 1 kilogram in 1 ton of feed. And we use probiotic, which contain a family from lactobacillus, streptococcus, and enterococcus, with the dose 100 gram in 1 ton of feed. In the first week, chicken were kept in one group and consumed standard feed. And Newcastle disease vaccine was given on day 4 of broiler production. In the second week, the chicken were grouped randomly into 4 groups. So for each group contained 15 chicken. The 4 group of chicken were treated with the mineral and probiotic and in a combination between mineral and probiotic. Data of feed consumption and body weight were collected every day. And serum sample were collected 2 weeks after vaccination and at the 28th of age. All data were collected into database and analyzed by statistic using ANOVA to determine the difference in its sample group. The difference between group were estimated with 95% confidence interval, and statistical analysis was conducted using SPSS program. This is our result from our research. The first is about the broiler productivity. From this table, we can see the result of feed consumption and feed conversion ratio between control and treatment. From control and treatment, we can see this is quite different, especially for body weight, it's quite different, around 200 gram. And for feed conversion rate, this is all of the group is less than 1.5 as a standard. But from here, we can see this is a good result because in the treatment group, the body weight is higher than the control group. And from statistical analysis, from all this group is significant difference for the feed conversion ratio. From this result, we can analyze that the sodium deformat and probiotic or combination can increase the body weight and feed efficiency. Because from the literature, sodium deformat can cause the digestive enzyme to work optimally, especially for pepsin. Sodium deformat also can reduce the digestive pH and can inhibit the pathogenic bacteria, especially for Salmonella. Another result is about the broiler immunity, and we measure with the titer antibody level in against Newcastle disease. And we can see the difference between the control and treatment group. We can see that in the treatment group, the level of antibody is higher than control group, especially for treatment with the sodium deformat or the third group, the fourth group is sodium deformat plus probiotic. From the literature, we can make summary that the feed supplement and probiotic can improve the immunity system of broiler. But from this this result, is there was not a significant difference in titer antibody between group. From our research, we can make some conclusion. The first is sodium deformat and probiotic and their combination is very efficient. Of feed consumption that indicated by feed conversion ratio. And probiotic and feed supplement can improve the immune system of broiler chicken. So sodium deformat or another mineral also and probiotic is the very potential be AGP replacement. For the next research, maybe from this research can develop again and modified and test with the larger population. So we can see more significant the difference between control and treatment group. Okay, that's all from me. And thank you very much for your attention. And we can continue with the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was a great presentation from Dr. Arya Eka Septana. Thank you, Dr. Arya, for informative and interesting presentation. Now, that's our presentation for this session, the last session. Now we are going to the discussion session. Well, we have several questions. No, just one question in the text box. Wait a minute, the question is come from... Oh, there is no question in the text box. Maybe Dr. Dinar will be help me to... Yeah.
Yes,
the presenter.
Actually, I don't have time to type, so I will speak directly. I interested with Miss Aulia's presentation. What is the reason that you took the data on the month of October? Is that any specific specific reason that you choose that month to take the sample?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Dinar Arifianto, for your questions. So basically, we don't have specific month to choose, but we usually carry out our research in a nocturnal sampling around 1:30 to 2 a.m. West Indonesian time, when maximum low tide occurs, so we can easily capture the gastropod using tweezer.
So rainy season or dry season doesn't matter, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Ms. Aulia. And also for Mrs. Anis Proponingrat, it's also interesting presentation. Do you have any comparison data? I'm sorry, what is the, do you have any data about other pine genus that have been already used for anti-cancer or maybe on the in vivo steps? So do you have any reference or data according to the other types of pines? This question is for Ms. Anissa Proponingrat.
Thank you for the question. For the Pinus mercusii, for this species of pine, this is the first report of study of it anti-cancer activity on especially on Hila cervical cancer cell lines. Especially for the leaf part of the plant. We look to another part of the plan. Actually, I have tested the three part extract of the Pinus mercusii on its anti-cancer activity on Hila cell lines, and it showed potential activity. But so far, I have not found for this species in vivo research. For pine species, other pine species like Pinus robuxi or Pinus maritima, have been conducted for the anti-cancer study, but the in vivo study is still rare, and yeah, that's.
Yeah, so this is the brand new idea. So good luck with your research.
Thank you.
Okay, and I have one question for Dr. Arya Ikaseptana. What is your opinion about the prospect of probiotic and other replacement of AGP in the future, Dr. Arya? Do you have optimism about this?
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Dinar. I think this is maybe last question, right? Because we are in the injury time before going join back to the plenary session. Okay. I think I'm very optimistic with we can substitute the AGP with another agent, because not only probiotic but another agent like mineral and other compound like a natural compound. I think it's very optimistic, but we should make another research also, especially to make a combination. I think because if only probiotic from my research also, this not too specific to increase the body weight or reduce the feed conversion ratio. I think we should make a combination between the probiotic and another component. But it's very optimistic to substitute the AGP for next time.
Yes, yes. We have the optimism about that. Thank you very much, Dr. Arya.
Okay, and thank you very much, Dr. Hina.
Dr. Arvendi Rahmajadi, I have question, but I will send you by email. Yeah, because I'm so sorry, because we are on the injury time, because all the participants and presenter should be joined to the plenary meeting room. So for this parallel session, we will end this session. Thank you very much for all the presenters and participants for your participation. And see you in the plenary session. So, oh yeah, I'm so sorry. Please now activate your camera if possible, because we have like 30 seconds to take a photo session. Okay, for all the participants and presenters. Okay, are you ready? So 1, 2, 3, first photo. Again, 1, 2, 3, second photo. And 1, 2, 3, third photo. Okay. Yes, that's all for me and Dr. Alfariza Nurul Rozi, behalving of the committee of ICHAFES 2021 and Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, say thank you and appreciate very much for all your attendance. We are so sorry for all the inconvenience and technical difficulties. We will meet in the plenary session, and we meet again in the second ICHAFES the other year. Don't forget to fill in also the feedback for us to make a better conference. Okay. Stay healthy, guys, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Yes.
Nice.
Dr. Woro.
Bye-bye. See you. Yes. Thank you so much. Yeah. What a great, thank good you. Job. Well done.
Stay healthy.
You can.
Say hi to all the Thai friends in Thailand.
Okay, see you.
See you, sir.
Thank you so much.